DSM-5, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. We finally got the fifth edition. The fifth edition has come about, and it's going to change some of the content of this particular section of material. I will point out where that occurs, where will be changes from notes you have to some additions and some subtractions in the way that these are covered. By and large, all the disorders that we're going to talk about are in there. They have changed categorizations. Sometimes they have mildly changed criteria for diagnoses. But like I said, we're not going to the level of diagnostics here where you should be able to diagnose somebody. In fact, I would warn you against diagnosing anybody with anything, including yourselves. Don't get medical student's disease or you read a bunch of symptoms and you think, oh my God, I have that. Right? I've got some rare tropical disorder. Because I got a headache. I've had a headache. I've had that. I've had this. Right? Probably you don't have these things, but you might, to be real about it. You might know somebody in your family. In fact, you're likely to know somebody that's affected by some of these issues we'll talk about, but don't diagnose people. You're not qualified, and you're not qualified to diagnose yourself. If you think there might be an issue, this is the place you find out whether or not you qualify to meet criteria for a diagnostic category. So for your test, you can know it as DSM-5. But it means Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, and as such, it is the go-to book that defines all mental disorders. That's the place that you go. Many people don't go there when they make their diagnoses. They don't double-check the criteria, which can be very extensive, and you have to be exhaustive and make sure that it's not better accounted for by some other issue. And we'll find out that misdiagnosis is rather easy to make in the realm of mental disorders, especially with some types of disorders, because some types of disorder categories share symptomology. And if you're not very well trained on differential diagnosis, you may not realize that this is better accounted for. The symptom presentation that I'm being faced with is better accounted for by somebody else, or excuse me, some other category of disease or disorder. And sometimes it could be disorder. Now, you don't need to know this for your test. Aren't you glad you come to class? And thank you all for coming. I appreciate you coming. This is the new general definition. I just thought it'd be nice for you to see it. A syndrome characterized by clinically significant disturbance in an individual's cognition, thinking, emotion, affect, regulation, behavior that reflects a dysfunction in the psychological, biological, or developmental processes, or all of the above. Underlying mental function usually associated with significant distress or disability in social, occupational, or other important activities. It's not just anything. It has to be serious. Having some symptoms, we might all have some symptoms of some of these things, doesn't mean that we rise to the level of a diagnosis of mental disorder per se. Further, an expectable or culturally approved response to a common stressor or loss, such as the death of a loved one, is not a mental disorder. Socially deviant behavior, politically deviant behavior. Some people get locked up in some countries for voicing opinions that are not in line with dictatorial governments. And what do you think they oftentimes say about those people? They're insane, they're crazy, they're unhinged. We need to lock them up for the good of society because there's something fundamentally wrong with them. No. Having different political opinions from the prevailing government's wishes for you to have certain opinions is not a disorder. Religious issues. We have religious freedom in this country. Any expression or any manifestation of religious or spiritual significance for you should be honored as just that, your religious freedom to do as you wish or not do as you wish. Sexual activity, as long as it's between consenting adults, is not necessarily problematic just because it's unusual statistically. And conflicts that are primarily between the individual and society are not mental disorders unless it results from a dysfunction in the individual as described above. So that's pretty exhaustive. And it should give us all pause to think that, wow, I ought to be really careful